Welcome to Calculation, the talk show. I'm Gary Johnson. We have Joanz and B with us today, and they're going to talk about their sound and what they're doing in the music industry. Joanz and B, how y'all doing this afternoon?
I'm pretty good.
Blaine, how you feeling?
I'm feeling good, man. Can't wait to see what y'all got to say now. I did a little prep for this interview. Guys appear to independently have been finding your voice or found your voice, and you're telling stories through music. I'd like for you all to talk about, number one, how did you guys meet? And number two, tell us more about telling stories through music. Over to you.
Through a mutual friend is how we met, actually. We were, I'll speak on my side of it. So we were both independent on our own and doing our own thing as far as music went. And both of us had some hardships as far as trying to get the sound out that we wanted or the reaction we wanted, just to leave an imprint or things like that of that nature. So once that said mutual friend put us together, the sound came, everything that we were looking for came, the recognition came, our fan bases combined, and we ran with it from there. As far as, our sound goes, I'll let B speak on that.
So ideally, as KJ said, we were making music independently, and it's been about 4 years now that we've been together, which has been an amazing journey. Our sound is unique, and I would say it as we like it to be outside of the box. We pride ourselves on not sounding like individuals that are in the industry now, because we're not trying to follow a trend. We're trying to be different. We're trying to be unique. And in the quality of the music that we bring out, I think it speaks for itself. We bring back the storytelling of music. And as Majmit said prior, it's the type of music that makes the hairs on the back of your neck stand up, right? You hear the instrumentation, you get a chance to pay attention to the lyricism, and actually are sitting there and are able to enjoy the ride throughout the music theatrics, if I may say.
Okay. Now, you all are unique in, maybe not unique, but I'm going to say unique. Somebody else can correct me later on. Let's talk about alternative soul. What does that mean? Alternative soul.
So to us, it means, for Joanz and B, we don't like to put a roof over anything that we do. There's no limit to anything that we produce, write, whatever artists we can work with, whatever the case may be, there's no limit to it. So you never know what you're going to get, depending on what vibe we're in, what mood we're in. We walk into the studio, you just never know. We never know what we're going to get. Like, we got a studio session coming up Wednesday, and we honestly don't know what we're going to make out of that. That's the alternative part, though. We like to be able to tap into all multitudes of walks of life and different people, ethnic groups, whatever the case may be. We just want to make sure that we are tapping into the sound that other people are familiar with. You don't want to just be a one-trick pony. So the more you can express yourself in different types of music is better for you and your fan base, because it shows that you're trying to relate to them and relate to the, whatever dances they may do there, or whatever, certain vibes there are. There's different BPMs for different, whatever the case may be. So that's the alternative part of it. Now, when it comes to the soul, every artist has that one goal to pierce the ear of the listener. But for Joanz and B, it's a little different. Obviously you're going to pierce listeners. You're going to pierce the ears of someone. That music's going to touch the ears of somebody. But what you want to do is leave an effective message that lasts and sticks with the subconscious and stays with the soul. So that's where our alternative soul genre is coined from.
B, you got anything to add?
That about says it, just making a sound that impacts your soul, something that relates to you, something that you're able to sit back and say, hey, like, this isn't just a song, this is a message. I can relate to this. So it's something that sticks and stays with you. the meat and potatoes of the music.
Okay. Yeah. I'm hearing you guys place no limits on what you do in terms of your music.
Absolutely not.
And do either one of you guys have any formal musical training, or how does that work?
Well, I'll let B speak on his vocals and, you know, everything he did with that coming up. But for me, it was a little bit different. I didn't really necessarily start with lyrics or anything, or actually, you know, producing songs or anything like that. I was actually more into the instrumentation. So first thing I can remember I picked up was drumsticks. And then after that, I started watching the organist and everybody at church. That's honestly, if you want to say anything about, you know, where anything came from, I can say that for the both of us is church. And growing in that, realizing that, you know, I could play different instruments and things like that, I went into school wanting to learn new things, and they offered band. So I took that, I took up the saxophone. And once I realized the notes were pretty similar in treble clef for other instruments, I realized that reading sheet music was something that was a lost art. So much of a lost art that they actually count it as a foreign language for college. Yeah. Wow. So that's really where my background in music came from. It started, and watching, you know, older family members before me that started this path, and it motivated me to do something with music, whether it be what we're doing now or anything else. But this is what worked out for us.
Okay.
I've been not so much in the playing aspect of things. I play the drums now, but as far as the training that I've had, I haven't had any actual class-wise training. I've been singing since the age of 3, so I've been in vocal class as far as choir, church choir, dad's choir, concert choir, every single year of school of my life, and pre-school. As far as church, I've done, you know, the church choir as well. So I've been singing, I've been perfecting my craft for quite some time now.
Okay. I want to talk about your single and stuff coming up. But before that, I want to talk about the business. What have y'all learned about the business? Because, you know, I go back working in the music business, going back to Van McCoy music and the hustle and stuff like that, and even before then. But there's some artists that I used to work with, man, that is just no longer there because they didn't do the business. They didn't know the business. They were very talented artistically, but didn't read the contracts, didn't read the fine print, didn't have somebody look over it, or they trusted somebody else to manage their money. I'll stop there. What are y'all, how are you all working out with the business?
You know, I said in a song once, puts the fear of God in people when you ain't ready, but you signed up now. That's what we have a lot of today. It's sad to see it because you are pretty much preying on a ambitious and hungry artist that's trying to get out of here. And the one thing that you have to do is place your aspirations and things to the side, you know, the tunnel vision that you had to just get to wherever you're trying to get with whatever craft it is. You got to put that to the side and really step out of the, I guess, dream phase of it all and the surrealness of everything, and really get down to the nitty gritty about, all right, what am I going to owe y'all? How long am I in this contract? Whatever the case may be, you really don't want to be looking like I've seen multiple, like that's one thing that as Joanz B3E, we do our research heavy. In interviews, we've seen so many artists that are out here talking about, you know, I just flipped to the pages where they're talking about how much money they're going to give you. But then you wonder why that said artist ends up on social media complaining about, I can't release music, I can't drop when I want to drop, I don't have control over what song gets put out, whatever the case may be. But you have to ask them, did you read what you signed? And almost 9 times out of 10, the answer is no. So we've had our, you know, run-ins with things like that, but because of the support system, and I know B's going to speak on this more, because of the support system and the people that we have around us that ground us, there's so many things that has been revealed to us through them and the help of them to make sure that we know what we're getting ourselves into. On top of that, making sure that even though they may not have, you know, the type of experience that we have with the music industry, they know that they have our best interest and they want to make sure that we know everything that's going on within that paperwork. So that's what pushes us even further to make sure that we do our research on whatever it is we're putting our, you know, black and white on.
Absolutely. Making sure that we are on the same accord, right? You want to be on one accord with the people that you have on your team, whether that be the business-minded individuals or the fashion-minded individuals or the individuals in general that are music savvy. We try to incorporate everybody's mind into one decision-making process because we don't want people, when you have, just because you have a team doesn't mean everybody's on the same accord, right? You may have one individual wanting to go left where the rest of the team is trying to go right. And if you have that, it could be that one roadblock that messes everything up. On top of that, the artists nowadays, and it's hard to say that in order to, the industry is, as what others will say, is 90% business, 10% talent nowadays. So you have to be business-minded. You have to understand that you can't do everything you want to do. Everything is going to be in a step-by-step phase to make you successful and to drive that success continuously. So we've had hurdles, you know, we don't always agree on things, but we, looking at the business side of things, we always make the best decision, the decisions that'll make us successful and the decisions that'll keep us and our music timeless.
Okay. In terms of learning, since we're still on the business, what's been your biggest light bulb or aha moment in learning the business?
I wouldn't necessarily say it was our big, like, oh man, okay. It was multiple minor situations that made us realize, like, okay, we need to pay more attention to what we got going on. And it put us in a situation where you'll see most groups split apart, but for us, we grew closer because it made us put both of our heads together to try and figure out what we want out of this. What exactly do we want? How do we want to carry our projects? Who do we trust to help back us? It takes two individuals to really be able to manifest certain things that one individual, no, not necessarily manifest it, but be able to identify certain things that necessarily one individual might not pick up by himself or herself. So in a situation where you have other bands and groups that might split up once they actually get to the nitty-gritty of the contracts, it made us come closer together to figure out, okay, so this is what we were in. Where do we want to go? Or this is where we're at. And where do we want to, numbers have been thrown at us, things, situations have been thrown at us, but now from all different aspects of what it takes to make or break an artist, we see what, you know, is needed in that lunchbox to be able to, all right, this is what we're going to use this for. You know, this is what we have this for over here, distribution for this over here, whatever the case may be. We had to sit down and really figure out what's a comfortable number for both of us. What is something that we're not going to go under? What do we not need right now? Because, you know, you can get into labels where they might throw things at you that you don't even necessarily need. But if you don't do your research, you won't know that you don't need it. They can tell you anything. So it was a huge learning curve, but I can't say or pinpoint one major thing that like made us go, oh, okay. It was a bunch of little things that God placed in front of us, little hurdles. And we had to figure out what lesson was in there. What would have looked like to outside eyes, what would have looked like a loss was actually us figuring out a lesson. And then that once we figured out that lesson, the way out of it came. That person, that individual, whatever the case may have been, that opportunity, it came. But in all of these lessons, there's something that collaboratively that you have to do with everyone on your team, and that's come together, talk it out, figure out a solution. If you split apart in certain situations or certain individuals don't feel as though they're heard, you're gonna have issues. So we've learned a bunch of different things on this journey, and we are still learning multitudes of different things that it takes to make a heck A-list or B-list or whatever you want to call it, celebrity, artist, whatever you're doing, whatever your craft is, we're learning what it takes.
I would also just add in there, kind of speaking on the same term, the understanding that the music industry is not the same industry it was 10 years ago, right? Right. It's not the same industry. It's not the same business mind. It may be the same structure. The same individuals that were in the industry may not be in the industry that were in there 10 years ago may not be in the industry that they are now, right? So it took an understanding that just because things were this way back then doesn't mean this is how things are going now, okay? And that we have to have an open ear and have to be able to correctly articulate exactly what we're doing as a team, exactly how we're going to intertwine the likely mindsets and get one thing established and get one thing done at a time instead of trying to independently do things separately and then expect things to come together, right? So I think that was a big thing, but we've overcome that, as KJ said, and it's just coming together as a unit and understanding either we sink or we swim together.
That's good. Sounds like you all got, as you say, the grounding, and you're able to recognize, look at the landscape, be prepared to pivot when you need to pivot if you got to change. So that's good. Who are some of the people who have influenced you musically and maybe outside of the music business?
I'll let B go first on this one, because as far as R&B goes and different vocalists and singers, we kind of had the same.
Yeah. I mean, we're all, you know, we're old school minded. You know, I won't say I don't listen to the newer R&B pop, whatever you may call it, but I'm still stuck on the 90s, 80s. You know, I was raised off the good music, you know, like the Commodores, Earth, Wind, and Fire, you know,
yeah,
you know, Michael Jackson, Prince, all the greats. And that doesn't say that doesn't mean I don't necessarily listen to the people now. You know, I still listen to some of the greatest vocalists of our generation and past tense, you know, Aretha Franklin, Whitney Houston, Fantasia, who is what
is that? There it is. At the shirt on.
Absolutely. Marvin Gaye and everybody, like even the gospel singers and stuff like that. So I have a lot. I don't have a favorite, and I would never, you know, try to knock anybody off of their greatness by trying to say a top five or anything like that. As far as hip hop, KJ's more cultured than the hip hop. But I'm R&B soul, you know, gospel. That's me all the way.
For me in hip hop, like with both of us, honestly, if we really like gave you all of our influences, we'd be sitting here for hours. Because this is just on two genres. We haven't dipped in the country, you know, rock, whatever the case may be. So, you know, just to stick to, you know, the rap and hip hop side of things, I'll say, you know, some of the influences are obviously, you know, Pac, Biggie, some of the trendsetters. Even Heavy D, you got to throw him in there, all the way to current situations or people who are still actively, you know, progressing and getting in here in the studio with these younger artists, upcoming artists such as Wayne or J. Cole and Kendrick, you know, all the way down to them to, this might be a little, you know, different for me, but I liked his story into the, you know, how he came into the music industry and how, you know, Dre and Cube and all these worked with him. Easy. I liked how his transition from what he was to an artist, how it came about, because it was honestly genuine to me. He was just really trying to learn everything himself. And when he did, it showcased, you know, once he actually put in the work, it showcased. So there's so many different positive influences for us that have we don't necessarily look at their music. We look at how they stood out, how they made themselves an individual in a group of people that are all doing the same thing. They stood out. They weren't afraid to be different. And it showed because now their songs are timeless.
Oh yeah. I asked that question because I was in the store this morning and I bumped into a lady that I only met her one time before, and she recognized me and she said that she was telling me about a concert she saw over the weekend with Brian Culbertson. And so I said, "Oh, I've seen him 5 times. He's one of my top five live performers." She's like, "Really?" I said, "Oh yeah. Yeah, he's top five." So she said, "So who else have you seen?" I said, "In terms of live performances, my father took me to see James Brown when he was in his heyday, and I ain't been the same since, you know." So I've seen James Brown. I've seen 3 stages of Michael Jackson, from the Jackson 5 to the Victory Tour, and then solo on his own. Earth, Wind, and Fire, best band ever, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, I could go on and on, man. So I said, "Let me see what you guys, you know, but that's good. You all got a blend, man. You all got it going on."
It's just about it for us. It's about being able to pay close attention to what has already been done before us, because that era of music, and I'll even stretch it all the way to the early 2000s, that era of music is still living on to this day. We're in 2024, going on 2025. We're halfway through 2024, and you still hear the some of the bands and names that you just mentioned, because those that song or their music is that much of an impact on people and cultures. It shifted the culture. Nowadays, you have situations where everyone is kind of like mimicking each other, and it's getting
I
a
know.
little boring, if I'm being
It
honest.
is.
It's like, where's the individuality? Where is the craftsmanship? Where is the structure? Where is the, you know, where who where did we lose the foundation for how to make a song? Going into the studio and just coming up with things on the fly, 10 to 15 minutes, whatever. Sometimes it's like that, but majority of the time, when you're really trying to do something and put a message in your song, you gotta let it marinate. You gotta sit on things for a little bit. And one talent that I'll say Joanz B actually has is the fact that sometimes we can make timeless songs in a matter of 10 minutes. It happens. But more often than not, there's certain situations where we got to sit on it. We got to really come together and think about it. Okay, play it over, play it again, run it back. Let's hear it again. Okay, at this point, you could probably take it up an octave here, and that'll really, because I can hear it, but I want to feel the goosebumps. That's really what we like, really how we grade our own tracks. Are we getting goosebumps from it? Because if we don't, is anybody around us getting goosebumps from it? If they're not, why put it out? We got to keep working on it.
That's a great intro to your music. So B, talk about your music. Let's let the people know what's going on.
Hey man, as we stated, and as we continuously state, it's timeless music. We like to call it timeless music because, as KJ said, when we're in the studio letting things marinate, and once you hear it a 10th, 11th, 12th, 50th, 60th time, you understand and are able to incorporate the decisions that you do with your music. And when you get to the point where you got the engineer picking up his personal mic and singing the song or his own lyrics into the song, you know, you got a good track right there. And we have individuals, and we not only have our team of, you know, individuals as far as the business mindset of things, but we have individuals that pride themselves in taking control and making sure they understand the music of today. So we can send them a song. "Hey, what do you think needs to be added to this? Or what can we lose? Or what could we do better on this?" And we have individuals that are solely based on rap, solely based on R&B, individuals that are from 10 years old, because we want to make music hit everybody, you know, from 0 to 100. So we have those stages of ages that are able to say, "Okay, well, the melody's tough here, but maybe some undertones here could be, or Jones, I see you said this on this part, but what about dropping the beat out and then just letting your lyricism flow right there?" So that's what we do, and that's how we get the sound that we get. And we're unique because in every hook, it's both of us. It's not just one. Whether that's me going over, or you know, under KJ's melody with higher and higher octave or you know, tones here and there that are lighter, or whether I'm on the main hook and KJ's under me with a lower octave. That's what we make sure that we do, and we incorporate in every single one of our songs, which makes us stand out, makes the sound what it is. Like the track that we have, well known, it wasn't a 15-minute track. It was a track that we sat on, and a track that was different, especially for me, having to rap on a track, something, you know, that I can do, but something that I'm not just going to jump out of bed and say, hey, I'm rapping today. You know, so that's another thing that makes us who we are. We push each other. We push each other to the max extent, saying, hey, even when I'm in the studio saying, oh, no, this is too high. I know I can't do this. And then you got Jones saying, no, you can, you know, but we're going to do this to make sure that you can hit this note, or maybe just stop where you're at, and then we'll record it in segments so that you can start with the note, not have to lead up to it.
Okay.
We always
that's your boy looking out for you, man.
Vice versa. It always goes both ways. That's more of our, you know, choir background from the church, like watching that director get people in the correct pitches, all that stuff like that, playing the keys, hitting it, making sure they're on the right octave, whatever the case may be. So even though I might not have the vocals that B has, I definitely know, again, from my background of reading sheet music and hearing instrumentation and watching that choir director, how things are supposed to sound, what notes are supposed to sound like what, you know, whatever scale we may be, whatever, it really plays on whatever scale the beat's in. So, you know, could be a minor, could be a major. That's a huge play. So that plays a role on how you're going to, you know, project your voice. So it all matters and it plays a role. And when we have those aspects that we bring to the table in the studio, it does nothing but help both of us.
Okay. Well, let's do some shameless plug-in, man. We talked about Well Known. Where can people find your music, website, videos? I know y'all on YouTube. I've seen you. So let's, you all talk about it. You all do.
The name is Joanz B, J-O-A-N-B-3-E, not pronounced B-3-E, is B. The three in the B-3-E is standing, and it comes from my third time of success. So it's the third time's the charm. B-3 stands for, but it's B. It's B. Almost had me say B-3-E. you can find us exactly on that. We made it pretty short and simple, and you can find us on Spotify, YouTube, any media outlet. You can find us on Facebook, Instagram. And if you want to just look at our faces, you can look at our faces. If you want to hear our music, we got stuff where you can hear our music. If you want to do both, well, we appreciate it. So it's Joanz B everywhere.
And make sure you go and turn on your notifications on all our social platforms so you know when our merch is dropping, the Well-Known video is coming. And you can get a heads up on this right here, our El Trador tequila that's coming.
Oh, man, look at y'all. Talk about business.
We got everything. I told you, man, the business. We had to do our research, and we wanted to step in with things that most artists or groups have not done. So,
man. I love it. All right, Joanz B. I'm going to see you guys Wednesday night. You're all going to be on another show. Y'all better be ready, man. The Thought Brothers are going to be waiting for you.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be a good show. All right, everybody. Joanz B, Well Known as the single. You can find them on blackmeninamerica.com and also on our Calculations Talk Show and all of our social media platforms. Until then, I'm Gary Johnson, and we're out of here. Hang on, fellas.
Appreciate it.
Niggas ain't been where I be.
Nah,
seen what I seen.
Now they
all on me.
And like they
all on me.
Nah, I ain't really with the handouts, and I don't wanna fit in, I'd rather stand out. See that fake ass shit get you no clout. Only on a nigga dick, cause you know now.
Niggas ain't been where I be.
Nah,
seen what I seen.
Now they
all on me.
And like they
all on me.
Nah, I ain't really with the handouts, and I don't wanna fit in, I'd rather stand out. See that fake ass shit get you no clout. Only on a nigga dick, cause you know now. How was that?